Here, we have a saying, no worries. Well, now you better start worrying. You'll be fine.
Down, down, baby, let's get on the down. Welcome on into WWE's The Bump. We are 45 days away from WrestleMania and less than 72 hours away from the Elimination Chamber going down in Perth, Australia this weekend. My name is Megan Morant, and joining me, as always, is Sam Roberts. Sam, how you doing on this monumental week?
When you put numbers on it like that, it gets even more exciting. We are so far down this road to WrestleMania, there's no getting off. What a weekend it's going to be. And what a way to start it here on The Bump, huh?
Yeah, of course. And we got to get it out to our friend Ryan Popola, because, Ryan, I would say it's been a pretty busy week in your world with everything that's going on right now in WWE.
Tangible excitement all over every single social media app that has ever been invented. We're going to talk about it all here today on WWE's The Bump. How do you do that? How do you get a part of it? Hashtag WWE The Bump. Facebook, X, Instagram, YouTube chat. I'm in there with you for the whole hour. Aiden, you wanted a shout out. You just got it. Thank you for watching. Get in on the conversation. Aiden, you're getting a shout out from all three of us. It's a big deal. Much like it's a big deal on this road to WrestleMania. Megan, hashtag WWE The Bump. Let's get into it.
Okay, and let's talk about who is coming on WWE's The Bump today. We have a star-studded lineup, and we had to have the Women's World Champion join us on The Bump. Of course, she is going to her home country of Australia, where she will defend that title against Nia Jax. She sat down with our very own Kathy Kelly. We're going to get to it later on in the show. And we also have one of the most exciting WWE superstars. He had a huge title defense last night on NXT. The North American champion, Oba Femi, joins us later on in the show. But before we can get to our guest, we got to talk about everything that's been going on in WWE, Sam, because you had to do an emergency podcast.
Wait. Did you say emergency podcast?
Oh, did you bring it?
I didn't forget it. I didn't forget it this time. Emergency.
I was waiting for the siren. I'm so glad you brought it.
Fool me twice, not going to happen.
Sam came prepared, and he was prepared on Friday night after this went down when The Rock and Roman Reigns returned to the Blue Brand.
You all have bought a side out of The Rock that you haven't seen in years. But you see, this side of The Rock has always been in here. Always. You shut your mouth, fatty. The Rock will come out there and slap the herpes off your lips. And you know why you're seeing it tonight? Because it's The Rock and Roman Reigns. The biggest WrestleMania main event in the history of WrestleMania. You had it in your hands and you let it go. You flushed it down the toilet. The same toilet you sat your fat asses on and you sat there and tweeted, "We want Cody, we want Cody. Cody's gotta finish his story. He gotta finish his story." You're laughing now and you're booing because you know it's true. Cody Rhodes, make one thing perfectly clear. The Rock is gonna do everything in his power to make sure that you walk out of WrestleMania what you are, which is a loser. Everything in his power to make sure that happens. Cody, your story is just ending. Our story is just beginning. The Bloodline, the most powerful dominant duo in sports and entertainment, and of course in the WWE. If you're No. Salt Lake City, sing along with The Rock is over. You lost that privilege. Sit there and shut your mouth and enjoy the ride that The Rock has taken you on. If you're some male, what the Bloodline is cooking.
Sam, he said the thing.
The new thing.
Yes.
The Bloodline is cooking. I mean, how do you not get excited seeing that? Roman Reigns said that everybody needed to listen to everything that they had to say because everything means something. And I think The Rock said even more than we realized he was saying.
Yes, I mean, even just the way he came out to the ring, dressed in this designer brand. I mean, this is a different Rock.
The $500 shirt-inspired vest that clearly costs a lot more than $500. I think what has happened is that the WWE Universe, whether they knew it or not, has woken up a beast that they woke up many, many years ago. And that's The Rock. And they've brought The Rock here. This, I don't think people realize how scary this is for the rest of the WWE roster. Seth Rollins, we were talking about it last week here on The Bump. Seth Rollins was talking about all the power that Roman Reigns had with that WWE Universal Championship and the fact that the Bloodline is that powerful of an entity. How do you make the Bloodline even more powerful? You add the most electrifying man in all of entertainment to it. The Rock is Bloodline, Megan. He's Bloodline.
Rock is Bloodline. Bloodline is The Rock and everybody in WWE. Better look out. Ryan, what is everybody saying on social media to this massive news that we saw on Friday Night SmackDown?
Megan, Sam, this will just be a small sampling of the overwhelming social reaction to all of this after Friday. I could do a whole section on just The Rock shirt. There was so many tweets, but as Good Times here says, Versace drip, Rock is back, and I am all here for it. We know Sam Roberts is as well. As we move over here to Pedro, though, I mean, you talk about a scary image of everyone throwing up the ones in the Bloodline, now including The Rock. You know, Pedro was taken aback by it, and it's an instantly iconic image. It will be interesting to see what that iconic image and now this iconic group does on the road to WrestleMania. As for The Rock himself, he had this to say after the fact. He's back. Greatness sins. Devil disrupts. Always speak the truth, even when he lies. Record-setting crowd, thank you, Salt Lake City. Mana, energy, eruptions, chill, signed, the People's Champ. And Sam, get out the alarm, because I think you could do an emergency podcast on just that post
tweet.
Alone.
Just
yes, you could. I mean, I went frame by frame on that segment with
you
The Rock.
You have to.
Trying to interpret all of that, and I could do the same thing on that tweet. There's so much happening that I don't think we even realized.
I love that he thanked Salt Lake City after just totally trashing everybody that has ever lived in Salt Lake City.
You're talking about the largest collection of trailer park trash that's ever been assembled under one roof? Congratulations, Salt Lake City.
Yeah, you guys did it. Anyways, we do need to move on to what happened on Monday Night Raw. And Sam, you talked about how strong the Bloodline is and how we don't even realize how much power they're going to be having. Well, we saw this start to take shape on Monday Night Raw in this historic matchup where Jey Uso had an opportunity to earn his first singles championship off of Gunther. But who's ringing that bell? Who's under the hood? It's Jimmy Uso. The Bloodline strikes again.
The Bloodline with black hoodies are always a problem. Nobody can survive it, even Jey Uso. And man, we were talking about this on Raw Talk as well. If anybody should be aware of the Bloodline's tactics, if anybody should be aware that the Bloodline is maybe more dangerous now than they ever have been, it's Jey Uso. He didn't see it coming. You know who did? Gunther. And that's why he was able to leave with the Intercontinental Championship.
And his historic reign continues on over 600 days as Intercontinental Champion for Gunther. Congratulations to Gunther on retaining that title. Elsewhere on Monday Night Raw, the night kicked off with an unbelievable matchup between two men that have massive chips on their shoulder in WWE, Cody Rhodes taking on Drew McIntyre. And Sam, we saw something that we thought was almost impossible, and that's Cody Rhodes losing for the first time since WrestleMania 39.
Two people have pinned Cody Rhodes. One of them's Roman Reigns since he came back, and one of them is now Drew McIntyre. I don't think that there is any feasible way. There it is, that all familiar black hoodie and Solo Sikoa's spike that Cody Rhodes knows all too well at this point, doing it again. And it gives Drew McIntyre this level of unprecedented momentum as he goes into the Elimination Chamber this weekend.
So Drew gets the victory. There's obviously a big asterisk next to that victory because of the interference from Solo Sikoa. But this is what Roman Reigns warned Cody Rhodes about. This is what Roman and The Rock said to Cody. The Bloodline is out to get him. They are out to get in the way. And I can't help but think about what Seth freaking Rollins told Cody Rhodes just a week ago, that he's ready to be his shield.
Yeah, Cody may not have any other option but to take Seth Rollins up on that. I mean, The Bloodline is like Babe Ruth. They're just calling their shots, and they do exactly what they promised that they're going to do. Seth asked Cody, what's your plan? If you're going to face Roman Reigns again this year at WrestleMania, what's your plan? And I think that when we saw Seth Rollins looking at Cody Rhodes, what we got was Seth saying, I told you so. Cody doesn't have a plan. That was exactly what happened at WrestleMania the last time Cody Rhodes got pinned. And it happened again. How does Cody Rhodes stop the Bloodline? It doesn't seem like he can.
Well, and then you look at it from Drew McIntyre's perspective, and McIntyre said on Monday Night Raw that he's saved WrestleMania, that he is the true workhorse of WWE. You know he's motivated after this victory.
Not only is he motivated, but now he's got people insulting him. On commentary, they're calling him a hypocrite, when in reality, Drew McIntyre seems to be the only person that's aware of the place that he exists in. Drew McIntyre is aware that he tried to fight reality. You can't fight reality. You have to live in reality. That's the reality that Drew McIntyre lives in. And now, instead of being a victim of it, he's going to benefit from it.
Well, Elimination Chamber is just 3 days away. And on Monday Night Raw, there was one final spot in the Women's Elimination Chamber match up for grabs. And it would be determined by a battle royal, Sam.
Look at this.
And first on Friday Night SmackDown, rather, there was another qualifying match. Zelina Vega would take on Tiffany Stratton to get to the Elimination Chamber. Tiffany Stratton so hungry and so impressive. Another qualifying match on Friday Night SmackDown. The Miz taking on Logan Paul in a SummerSlam rematch.
And there he is. Talk about calling your shots. Logan Paul letting the world know that he is headed to Perth and he gets the three count. Logan Paul looking to become a double champion at WrestleMania.
And then how about Kevin Owens taking on Dominic Mysterio? Kevin Owens told everybody that he's dedicating this matchup to Rey Mysterio. So we know somewhere Rey Mysterio beaming with pride as Kevin Owens gets the pin over Dirty Dom. R-Truth celebrating. It looks like it's sinking in that he's not part of the Bloodline.
Dom's going to be eating chicken tenders through a straw after that kick.
Another qualifying matchup on Friday Night SmackDown. Naomi, her return to in-ring action, and she was feeling the glow against Alba Fire. And this is a Naomi that she wants to come back here and get back to the top in WWE. The first step, qualifying for the Elimination Chamber. And then on Monday Night Raw, it was that Women's Battle Royal for the final spot. Raquel Rodriguez returns and capitalizes against Chelsea Green.
We almost had it. We almost had that miracle moment. And as dominant as we thought Raquel Rodriguez was in that Battle Royal, nobody looked more dominant on Monday Night Raw than Nia Jax, just coming through and laying out an entire chamber's worth of the top female superstars on the roster.
And how about Nia Jax making that statement? The field is now set for the Elimination Chamber in Perth, Australia. So many dominant women in this matchup. Becky Lynch, Bianca Belair, Liv Morgan, Tiffany Stratton, Naomi, and the returning Raquel Rodriguez. All of these women want to make their way to WrestleMania, but Sam, only one can emerge from the Elimination Chamber match.
It's the biggest women's Elimination Chamber match we've ever seen in the WWE, and it should be because it leads to the Women's World Championship match at the biggest WrestleMania of all time. One wins, five are going to lose.
A trip to WrestleMania is on the line in the Elimination Chamber men's matchup. Look at some of these former WWE champions. Kevin Owens, Drew McIntyre, Randy Orton, Bobby Lashley, The Maverick, Logan Paul, and the hungry LA Knight.
This is what the WWE is all about. When you look at this field, like you said, you've got former WWE champions in there. You've got former Universal champions in there. You've got LA Knight, who scratched and clawed to get to the position that he's in. And then you got Logan Paul, who got famous on social media and has entered into this world and claims he's doing it better than anybody else.
Yeah, he also claims that he will come out of the Elimination Chamber as a double champion in WWE. I don't know if the WWE universe is ready for that.
No, I don't think. I'm not. No. I don't think anybody's ready for that. Here's the problem with Logan Paul is that the things that he says end up being true. He's got this ego. It's so hard to deal with Logan Paul, and then he wins matches, and then he gets titles. And yes, if he wins the chamber match, which he's got a 1-in-6 shot chance of doing, He goes to WrestleMania. He gets a WrestleMania rematch against Seth Rollins. And he could be the WWE World Heavyweight Champion. That's nuts.
It's so much coming out of the Elimination Chamber. It all goes down on Saturday. The kickoff show. Join me, Sam Roberts, our friend Peter Rosenberg, 4 a.m. Eastern time on Peacock. The Elimination Chamber starts at 5 a.m. Eastern time. So set those alarms. Ryan, I know you got your set already.
Yeah.
What's social media saying about the Elimination Chamber?
We are all excited for Elimination Chamber this weekend, but we also had just an absolutely incredible edition of Monday Night Raw earlier this week. And now listen, we've had call-outs before on Monday Night Raw, but never one quite like this. Let's take a look.
Now there's a man from Ireland that's been making me wait for way too long. And I still got one dude on my mind. Conor McGregor, get your candy ass back to the octagon. We got some unfinished business, boys. God bless. I'll see you at the top.
No standing ovation was ever more deserved. That was incredible. Pat McAfee thought so. Okay, Michael Chandler, that fight would be magic. Pat, of course, had a great view of it right there at the commentary desk. And then Michael Chandler, he went on social. He talked about how cool of a moment it was, but he also said, wait, Pat, you said I was shirtless in the crowd. Do you believe him? Well, Michael Chandler, we can now confirm via Michael Chandler's social accounts. Indeed, he was so amped up after the fact. There it is, right
there.
Look
at that. Yeah. What a body on that guy.
A moment and a half. Can't wait to see what develops with all of that. What a cool moment on Monday night. Now let's talk about something that maybe wasn't as ideal for Bayley and Dakota on Friday, because as Carter here says, it's going to take a little while for Bayley to trust Dakota again. We saw that video of them last week with them not necessarily walking together even after Dakota made the save last week, and people are stressed out, including Crispy Wrestling, who's really going through it. Mm. Damn, Bayley still doesn't trust Dakota, and it's either Dakota is lying and Bayley sees through her, or Dakota actually will side with Bayley through the whole thing. This is too much. However, not all hope is lost, because a great point here from Slater, who says, you guys are still skeptical of Bayley and Dakota's friendship. They're literally wearing almost the exact same outfit. So make of that what you will, but a reason for some optimism, perhaps. One more, we'll stay with SmackDown. Let's talk about a massive signing we saw on Friday night. Let's talk about Bron Breakker, who Crossing says is about to put everyone on SmackDown on notice. I am so hyped to see what comes of him being there. Everyone is hyped, including Triple H, who posted this after the fact on Friday. Unlimited potential, an already impressive resume, and he's got that dog in him. Welcome to SmackDown, Bron Breakker. This is a big one. Cannot wait to see what Bron Breakker does on SmackDown, Megan, starting this Friday night.
Oh, I can't wait either. Bron Breakker, the best spear in the business. I think that might be up for debate.
But
he claims it is the best spear. I do have a quick question for you about damage control.
Yeah.
So Io and Kairi and Asuka, they say that they are damage control. Well, Bayley invented this group. Why aren't Bayley and Dakota damage control?
Because who's got the gold? What symbolizes leadership in a group? Whoever's got the gold. The WWE Women's Champion, Io Sky, is the one with the gold. They made this supergroup, and the members of that supergroup that have all the gold are the ones that take the titles with them.
You have the gold, you get to keep the name. And speaking of gold, oh my goodness, the bump is dripping in gold today. It's time now to send it out to Kathy Kelly, who has a very special sit-down interview with the one and only Women's World Champion, Rhea Ripley, who is getting set to compete in her home country, Australia, at the Elimination Chamber.
I am sitting down with the Women's World Champion, Rhea Ripley. Rhea, thank you so much for joining us today.
Of course. Thanks for having me.
First off, I will say you look incredible.
Thank you. So do you.
Thanks. Oh my gosh, okay. A little nervous for this one, but talking about Elimination Chamber in Perth this Saturday, It feels very faded for you, I'm assuming.
Yeah, I mean, I'm super excited for it. Mm-hmm. This feels like WrestleMania before WrestleMania for me.
When is the last time that you wrestled in Australia? It was before you got signed, right?
Yeah, so the last time I wrestled was 2017, 2016, something like that. It's been 7 years.
Yeah.
So it's been a long time, and I've been wanting to go home for a long, long time and do this. So I'm glad that the opportunity has finally arose, and it is Elimination Chamber, and I am the face of the PLE for WWE.
Absolutely incredible. I know that big matches, they sometimes feel surreal until they happen. Mm-hmm. Has this fully sunk in yet?
No, it hasn't. I think in this crazy world, which is WWE, we're so go, 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 never really stopping. So I haven't had time to really process too much what is happening. I've processed like the little bits and pieces, like the hashtag on X, having my little face in emoji next to it. That's been really cool. But I haven't actually processed that we're going to Australia and I get to face Nia for my Women's World Championship, and I get to go home and perform in front of my family and friends that never really get to see me compete.
Yeah.
It hasn't really sunk in. I think the moment when I step through the curtain and hear the crowd, that's when it's going to properly sink in, and then maybe an hour or two after the match is finished and done and I get to cool down, calm down, and take it all in, it's going to be a very, very emotional flight back to
I can imagine. Experiencing the separation anxiety as well. The homecoming, and then that'll be such a high. You mentioned friends and family that are going to be there. I know you've had your family come to WrestleManias in the past. A couple of people have gotten to see you stateside, but who exactly is going to be there?
So I got a few people. I got my mom and my dad. They came to a WrestleMania 39.
Oh, I met them, I know.
Yeah, she's met the family, guys.
They approve.
Yeah, they do. They really like you. They do. But yeah, I have my mom, my dad, my uncle Rob, who was also at WrestleMania, and then my sister will be there, my friend from high school, Soraya, will be there, Rob's kids, so my cousins, Brody and Sam, they'll be there, and then we have some family friends, and my uncle Neil, and yeah, a few people.
So a whole crew.
Yeah, there's going to be a whole crew.
And then everyone there, pretty much, will be there in support of Rhea Ripley.
All my Australians, so I can't wait to hear it.
Were there people, when you expressed that this was your dream of being a WWE superstar, that either didn't believe in you or encouraged you to take another path? And have they asked you for tickets?
I don't know if they asked me for tickets because, to be honest, I have blocked a whole bunch of people.
As you should.
Yeah.
Don't get on our bad side.
No, don't, because I'm either going to roast you online or I'm just going to block you. Depends on what day I'm having, you know, if I'm busy or not. But, yeah, those people that doubted me through the whole thing. Like, I've had school teachers that laughed in my face when I wanted to do projects on WWE and wrestling in general. I had people judge me for wanting to try out for Riot City Wrestling, which is the independent scene that I wrestled for in Australia. And then even just having the plan that I did to try and dedicate my craft and make it to WWE, I had people all the time like, you should, like saying, you should find a real job, you should study, you should do something else, like you're never gonna make it, it's never gonna happen, it's a silly dream, you have to be more realistic about your life. And the one thing I have to say to that is, where are you guys? Like, honestly.
That's where they are.
I mean, exactly. I'm here living my dream. I worked hard for this dream, and they're miserable in their little crappy lives, so.
Yeah.
Sue me.
Well, either they'll be there in Perth or they'll be watching from home, because it is inescapable if you're in Australia. I feel like you are everywhere. Having gone on a media tour, I didn't want to bring them up, but Dom, how was that?
The sass.
Well,
it was good. It was a lot of fun.
Okay.
It being Dom's first time in Australia as well, it was really fun to share some Aussie things with him and watch him just take it all in and get excited for the PLE as well, because how can you not get excited? We got to see the stadium from the outside. I haven't been on the inside yet, but like even at nighttime, because time zones, you know, we were awake. So we went for a long walk. We walked all the way from the hotel to the venue and walked around the whole stadium.
Sounds really romantic.
You know.
Yeah.
Sorry.
We can take a walk sometime.
We'll take a walk too. This trip will take a walk.
Okay.
But it was good, and we got to do some fun, like touristy things as well, which I don't really get to do going home. Like I normally go home, I see my family in Adelaide, and that's about it.
You don't get to hold capybara?
No, exactly.
Just just in your normal everyday life.
Exactly. Like the quokkas and all that, they were really cool to take photos with. I've never seen a quokka in my life. So getting that experience and feeling sort of like an outsider in my own home, it was actually a nice feeling. It was refreshing. I had to go to the beach and just take it all in. For a media tour, it wasn't really media. It was just fun. So I'm excited to go back.
Yeah, a lot more on your plate and a lot more on your mind this time going back.
Oh, definitely. Now I have to actually put my title on the line instead of chill by the beach. So there's a lot more going into this one, and I feel like it's going to be a very stressful, chaotic week, but it's going to be so amazing at the same time.
Yeah. Well, you have a lot to juggle at Elimination Chamber. Not only is the Women's World Championship on the line against Nia Jax, but you're going to have some sort of focus, assuming that you retain your championship, on the Women's Elimination Chamber match. Is there anyone who's going into that that you're especially keeping your eye on?
I mean, they're all credible in their own different ways. They're all threats. Liv, she has it out to get me. I don't blame her, but you know, that's a long story. Then we have Bianca. She is absolutely amazing. She's the EST of WWE. She's gonna be a challenger as well. Becky Lynch, someone who continuously likes to cut me off when I'm talking and just runs her mouth about me. She's also made quite a name for herself here in the WWE. She's done a lot here, but it's mommy's time. And to be completely honest with you, yes, I will keep my eye on the Elimination Chamber. I'm focused on Nia Jax. And once this is all done and said and it's over and we're heading back, then I'll worry about whoever wins it. But mommy's always gonna be on top. So should I be worrying about them? Or should they really be worrying about me?
That is a good question. I'm the one usually asking the questions, but that was a really good one. I will give it to you,
Exactly.
Talking about Nia Jax, ever since she came back, it really feels like her sights have been set on you. Do you feel like this is personal at all?
I feel like it is, but I don't really know why. I don't understand why Nia has targeted me the way that she has. I get that I am the top dog, I'm the Women's World Champion, but you can't just come back and sneak attack people until you get a title shot. Like, you haven't stepped in the ring with me one-on-one, so what makes you think that you deserve to do that? Obviously, she attacked me a fair bit, and then she went on her merry way and did a couple other things, because we went to Saudi Arabia. I beat all five women, and I retained my Women's World Championship. So she had no choice but to go on to other women. And yes, she did have a match with Becky. And she did beat Becky Lynch. The man, Becky Lynch. So once she did that, she had something, I don't know, she had an ego. She had a chip on her shoulder. So what does she do? She comes back after me. But like I said before, all she does is hit me from behind. When that bell rings, and I'm staring her in the face, eye to eye, it's a different Rhea Ripley. I got my eyes set on you, and to be completely honest, you're gonna have to do a lot more than just hit me in the back.
Yeah. Going back to that Fatal Five Way at Crown Jewel, being in the ring with her, even though there were other superstars in there with you, is there anything that you can take away, anything that you learned in that match that you were going to use in your game plan at Elimination Chamber?
I mean, I can't give you all the secrets because, you know, she might watch this.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So I don't want to spill the beans.
We can talk about it later.
Yeah, we'll talk about it later.
Okay.
but, I mean, I knew Nia was a threat. I always knew Nia was a threat. She's powerful. She's strong. She's really good at what she does. She's smart. But so is mommy. So everything that I've learned from her, I hope she's learned from me too. Because I want to go into this match and I want everyone to be on their A game, ready for war. Because once I stand victorious at the end of it, she's going to have no excuses.
Well, some of the other women that we've discussed earlier, Becky Lynch, we have to talk about the WrestleMania kickoff in Vegas the other week. Becky had some choice words for you.
Yeah, she did. She said that I'm gonna find out what it feels like to be on the bottom. Intriguing. That's really intriguing. I don't know that feeling. Becky, she talks a big game. She's very smart and she's articulate and she's very good on the microphone. But to get mommy on the bottom, that's a lot of work. That is a lot of work. And you can continue to cut me off and run your mouth. But to be completely honest, like I said with Naya, once that bell rings, I'm a different Rhea Ripley. I'm not gonna be nice anymore. I'm not gonna humor the fact that you're talking to me. I'm gonna rip your bloody head off.
Wow.
So, talk your talk, as long as you can walk the walk.
I mean,
doesn't mean anything.
It really does feel like we see two of the most dominant women in WWE face off at that kickoff. But you can never really count out someone who is out for revenge. And Liv Morgan has said in both interviews with me and when she was on the bump that she is on her revenge tour, she is in her revenge era, and you are public enemy number one.
It's cute. Revenge tour.
Yeah.
Should be a shirt. WWE should make that into a shirt. I might wear one. But yeah, Liv, look, I understand why she's on this revenge tour. I understand why she's out to get me. We were a semi-successful tag team in Liv for Brutality, and our connection was fantastic. We meshed together really, really well. I have to say that because it's true. Like, I'm not gonna lie about it. But once I saw the bigger picture and I realized that I wasn't going to accomplish anything being in that tag team, I obviously had to make the smarter decision for myself. I'm so sick of losing. I'm so sick of being the underdog and, like Becky would put it, being on bottom. So I don't understand really why the revenge tour is towards me. It's a little bit stupid to me, don't you think?
You asking great questions again.
Exactly.
That I don't necessarily have the answers for. I know that you guys do have a long history together, but since then, you have aligned yourself with the Judgment Day.
Yeah.
They are juggling so many things at the moment. The boys seem like they are, you know, defending the Undisputed Tag Team Championships. They're getting caught up with R-Truth.
Oh, God.
What do you make of all of that?
Yeah. Yeah. The R-Truth thing is comical. It's very, very comical, but like I've said to the boys, he's not in. Like, we've all come to the agreement, R-Truth isn't in, so we need to stop with that. We need to get rid of him, and we need him to get the message that he's not a part of the Judgment Day.
Yeah. He should just watch the interview that you did where you said that you would want me in the Judgment Day, and then maybe
exactly.
He'll. Yeah.
Exactly. Kathy Kelly in Judgment Day. Sounds pretty bloody good to me. But I don't know, I feel like here on Raw, the Judgment Day, we ran Monday Night Raw. We ran the WWE, and I feel like with everything that's been going on, we've lost a bit of steam, and that makes Mommy very mad.
Which is crazy to think because of how much gold you guys are holding at this moment.
Exactly, and I feel like it's because Truth is just such a funny dude. And he, for some reason, loves the Judgment Day, wants to be a part of us.
Some reason loves the Judgment Day. I feel like everyone loves the Judgment Day.
I mean,
maybe those that get in their way don't, but.
Well, yeah, but they also know that they're not good enough to be a part of it. So me and the boys, we want to be taken seriously. So that's why we keep attacking Truth. We want him gone. We want him to leave us alone. But he's like a cockroach. He just keeps coming back. But as for the tag team championships, yes, they're going to be on the line in Australia against Pete Dunne and Tyler Bate, and I'm going to be watching that very closely as well.
Yeah.
My boys, Send Your Money in the Bank, Damian Priest, and Finn Balor, they are going to pull through and they're going to keep their Undisputed Tag Team Championships. And that's all I really have to say about that. They're dominant. They always have been. They always prove and show everyone what they're capable of.
Yeah.
Now they just got to show, you know, Pete and Tyler, exactly what that brutality feels like.
I mean, I feel like with everything that's on your plate that day specifically, to be there and support them as well is just a testament to how close you guys all are.
Yes, yeah. We're a very close-knit unit, and we've really we've really become family.
Yeah.
Like, I love them boys.
Yeah.
I really do. They're my family, and I'm theirs, and you can feel it, and you can see it when we go out there together. We're just so connected.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we all travel together. We stay at the same hotels.
Mm-hmm.
We're always around each other. So I've been missing going out there ringside with them.
Yeah.
But mommy's got business of her own to deal with, so.
Exactly. And the leader really doesn't need to be out there all the time.
I mean, we don't have a leader, but.
Oh, okay, yeah.
You know, I do come up with some really good game plans, though. So,
that you do.
Game plan master.
So you have been on this incredible run as of late.
Mm-hmm.
There have been so many moments that I feel like I can't even list them all off, but is there a moment from this last year that stands out to you as a favorite?
Oh, I mean, there's so many, like you said. I feel like, obviously, WrestleMania 39
mm-hmm.
is one of the big moments for me.
Yeah.
Especially after WrestleMania 36. That was my first WrestleMania, and it obviously ended up being at the Performance Center. My family couldn't be there.
Yeah.
I was facing Charlotte Flair, someone who I wanted to face at Mania since I started wrestling for WWE. I had my NXT Women's Championship on the line, but I lost everything.
Mm-hmm.
There was no one in the crowd. My family couldn't be there. I lost my championship to Charlotte. Then to get it all back at WrestleMania 39 and get the SmackDown Women's Championship off of her by defeating her in front of a packed out crowd, in front of my mum, my dad, and my uncle Rob, that was a really special moment for me. And that is probably my favorite moment from this past year, I want to say.
Yeah. We always talk about this in other sports of how having a home court or home field advantage mm-hmm. is so crucial.
Oh, yeah.
We don't really ever talk about that in WWE. So mm-hmm. having that pressure, not having people there who are absolutely going to be in your corner,
mm-hmm.
Now going into Perth.
Mm-hmm.
Is there an added amount of pre-match nerves, or do you feel like you're going to be more settled?
I don't know. I feel like my nerves are so wishy-washy sometimes. Like, I don't know how I'm going to feel. Knowing that I'm home as well, like, just knowing, well, hopefully, that I would get such an amazing reaction from the Perth crowd, from the Australian crowd. It makes me feel proud, happy, nervous, elated, everything. All the emotions all in one, and I just don't know how I'm gonna react to that on the day. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I'm gonna get emotional like Zelina Vega in Puerto Rico.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's gonna happen to me. I don't know if it's gonna make me zone in more to the point where I don't see anything else but Nia.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how my body is going to naturally react, but I'm very intrigued to see what happens.
Yeah. Considering the waterworks that were after WrestleMania 39, mm-hmm. I would assume that at least after the match, you're going to be a little dehydrated from crying so much.
Probably. I mean, if I'm not dehydrated going into the match, I'm definitely going to be that way after. Especially if my family and friends get to come back after the match, I'm definitely going to be a mess. Yeah. So please do not follow me too closely with the cameras, fellas.
Keep your distance, or at least bring tissues for you.
There we go.
That would be very helpful. Yeah.
So I can wipe all the sweat and tears from my eyes.
I am very bummed that I won't be there because I would have done that for you. I know Samantha and I will be watching from home live. I will be waking up that early to do it. But before we wrap up, any final message for Nia Jax?
Run. Just simply run. Don't look back. You really think it's smart playing with me? You really think it's smart attacking me from behind every single week to the point that it just angers me more and more, adds on to that? Run. Because once we're in that ring and you're stuck in between those ropes and you can't leave, it's gonna be all over for you. Your nightmares are gonna be a reality.
Wow. Well, I am very grateful to be on your good side, and Rhea, thank you so much for joining me for the sit-down. This was an absolute pleasure, and good luck with everything at Elimination Chamber.
Thank you. Appreciate you.
Friday. Brace for brutal force. Rhea Ripley.
This is my division because mommy is always on top.
Nia Jax.
Nia Jax just plowed through the champion. The irresistible force has been nearly unstoppable. And here we go, and the fight's on for the Women's World Championship.
And speaking of Rhea Ripley, you hear them right now. One of her favorite bands, Motionless in White, which is featured in Rhea Ripley's theme song, Demons in Your Dream. The band's song, We Become the Night, is an official theme song of Elimination Chamber Perk. We Become the Night is from the album Scoring the End of the World, and it is available right now on Apple Music and Spotify. Get that on your playlist, Sam.
Yeah, well, if anything is going to fire me up the way that interview with Rhea Ripley fired me up, then I'm going to put it on my playlist. Look, based on what I just saw, first of all, shout out to Kathy Kelly for maintaining her journalistic integrity and shooting her shot, which I respect.
Yes.
I think that when you listen, there's two stories that Rhea Ripley was telling there. One is this story of somebody who could be very overwhelmed by the moment, who is going to sit there and see Uncle Rob in the audience and is going to realize she's home. And the other is that laser-focused one on Nia Jax. One of them might not walk out the champion. The other one is almost guaranteed to.
She understands the magnitude of this situation and just how much it means to her to be in her home country. Ryan, what did you think about all of this?
Oh, an absolutely incredible interview. And Sam, you're absolutely right. We are so fired up for Elimination Chamber this Saturday, but we're also fired up for Sunday because it's that time of year again, everyone. And WWE Superstar Sundays are back in a big way. Unrivaled storytelling reigns supreme on A&E. The new season's premiere with A&E's WWE rivals, Triple H versus The Rock, and then WWE legends Randy Orton. All part of WWE Superstar Sunday, starting this Sunday at 8 on A&E. Let's check out some of the highlights from what we can expect to see on Sunday.
This was The Rock at his finest.
And you had the perfect foil in Triple H.
WWE rivals.
Easy for us to clash. Probably the greatest matches I've ever had.
And then WWE legends.
I didn't understand what it was to be the face of the WWE.
He had figured it out. He just had to do it his own way.
WWE Superstar Sunday. New season premieres Sunday at 8. Only on A&E.
Now, we cannot wait for both specials, but what we thought we would do, we'd have a little bit of fun. So on the Bump X account, we posted up a poll. And in light of the Rivals episode coming up this Sunday, were you Team Rock or were you Team Triple H? You can kind of see it behind me. Let's get that official verdict.
Oh!
61% Team Triple H was the answer right now. You can still vote on this poll for a little bit longer, so if you want to change that result, go for it.
You're sweating. Cannot wait. Are you all right?
No, I'm not.
Yeah, Sam, actually, this is, we got to check on you after all this, actually.
I'm fine. I mean, votes are anonymous, right? That's an anonymous poll.
How many times did you vote?
It's anonymous, right?
You can only vote one. Sam, you keep your votes very private, right?
Very private.
He's got like 16 burner accounts, so he may have rigged this one a little bit.
Yeah. Well, no. Very private, and it's good. We'll maintain professionalism here. I don't take sides. I generally don't take sides.
Cannot wait to see that A&E special that is coming your way. It's going to be awesome and much to unpack. Speaking of awesome, it is time to bring on our next guest to WWE's The Bump. He's one of the most exciting superstars in WWE. He is on an 11-month win streak, including a big victory last night where he defended his North American Championship against Lexus King. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome on Oba Fett. Femi to The Bump.
Yeah.
Thank you for having me.
Oba, thank you so much for making the time. Welcome on into The Bump for the first time in your career. How you doing this afternoon?
I'm doing well. I already did the necessary things this morning. Woke up, prayed, ate well, and I had a workout this morning, so I feel great.
immediately turning the page from your championship defense last night against Lexus King. This was a big match for you. How are you feeling less than 24 hours removed from your victory?
Well, I feel, I didn't expect it to be too much of a challenge. I know that Lexus is more of a cunning superstar, not really known for his brute strength or super athleticism, but like he's very tricky and very, very slippery by nature. And I think I overcame the challenge relatively easily. My arm is a little bit banged up, but altogether I'm well.
It's been amazing watching this whole rise happen, and I think a lot of us fans have gotten swept up in it and watching. I would describe it as meteoric, without hyperbole. For you, is this something you expected? What has it been like for you to come from scratch and be at the top already?
Well, as a child, I've told this story a million times, but as a child, right from being born, I was told that you're going to be special. You are going to do special things. Imagine being 2 years old and everyone around you who is royalty in your family is telling you that you are going to be great and living with that pressure for 25 years. So this coming to fruition, me winning the North American Championship, me getting signed by the WWE, all that has been expected.
High expectations for you, literally from the minute that you were born. You made your in-ring debut just over a year ago, and now you already have that title over your shoulder. What would you say is the biggest difference in your game between your debut and Obafemi right now?
Ooh. Well, I had to tone back with the aspect of just being brutishly strong, because like strength is a big part of this game, but like there's other things you can learn. There's the psychology of it, there's the cardio of it, because I mean, no matter how strong you are, if it's minute eight and you don't pack the same power you packed in minute one, it's irrelevant. So I had to work on my cardio and my endurance, and I say that is the biggest difference between the Oba then and the Oba now.
Let's talk about the kind of road to getting to the Oba now. And I think the road that a lot of us saw was that breakout tournament. You walking in and talk about dominating, winning the NXT Men's Breakout Tournament. And I think that it's one thing to win the tournament. It's another thing to have every fan watching that tournament go, yeah, that's a star right there immediately. I'm sure that you walked in with the intention of winning that tournament. Did you realize how quickly that the WWE and the NXT universe would recognize you as having the abilities that you think you do?
Well, I've tried my best to stay away from worrying about what other people think. For me, it's all about waking up and doing what you're supposed to do. I mean, I took every single challenger in that tournament just as serious as the rest. I mean, I never underestimated anybody. I never said, oh, Riley Osborne is small, so I'm going to like, you know, just, it's going to be a cakewalk. And I never treated any of those guys like that, because that's how people get beat. So I woke up, I did my thing, I took every challenge seriously, and I just let the WWE universe and the NXT universe react to me the way they wanted to react to me. I can't control what people think of me. And I'm just going to do what I'm going to do. And that's my mentality.
Now, Oba, that's absolutely amazing. As we bring it to social, though, let's keep up on the breakout tournament for just a second, because there was one moment in that tournament that had everyone stop and go, wow, let's take a look and a listen right now. Oba, I'm not ashamed to tell you that I've watched that on a loop for more hours than I can count. For you, what was it like when you, after the fact, were able to both watch and hear just how absurdly loud that was?
Me, personally, I was going for a high five. He forgot to high five me back, and the sound just happened. It's just an after effect of the action.
Absolutely incredible moment, and that obviously set the stage for what would come shortly after. That's, of course, you becoming what we see over your shoulder, that NXT North American title, and you becoming North American champion, you know, parlaying the contract, cashing in, and defeating Dragon Lee to become champion. A monumental rise, as Sam said. So many posts like this one of people that were just absolutely amazed that all of that happened in such a short period of time. Not because of your talent, but just because of how quickly it all happened. What was that night and that moment like for you?
It was a moment of opportunity. I saw my opportunity and I took it. Earlier that day, I was in an interview and Lexus King just happened to interrupt me. That seems to be a running theme. And he was trying to nudge me to go for the NXT title while he goes for the North American Championship, because he had a match with Dragon Lee later that night. And he just gave himself away by telling me that piece of information. So I was like, okay, well, Dragon Lee and Lexus King face each other tonight. Whoever wins is probably still banged up from the match. So I'm coming out tonight, and I took my opportunity.
Took your opportunity, you did, obviously, our new North American champion. Now, you touched on this a little bit a moment ago. There are so many posts, Oba, like this. That was absolutely amazing. Oba has star written all over him. Or Jonah here says, Oba Femi has so much aura. We know you said that you're able to just kind of focus on the tasks in front of you and kind of block out the reaction, whether it's positive or negative. Is there a reason that you think you're able to do that? Maybe it's because you've kind of been used to people being so impressed with you throughout your entire athletic career, even before WWE?
Well, I struggled with this personally. Even in my years of being a collegiate athlete, I always used to worry about what people would think of me. And it was at the very moment that I stopped worrying about what people thought and just executed the task at hand. That's when I started to see monumental success in my career, in my game, in every aspect of my life. Because if you just do what you feel is right and what you know you're supposed to do, you'll have 100% more chance of executing what you're trying to execute. If you're worried about what people think, then you'll start worrying about, oh, does my foot look right? Or does my neck look right? Or is my head positioned well? And all those things are just minor distractions that take you away from your game. Why not just do what you're supposed to do? So that's the kind of ideology I adopted, and it has worked for me ever since.
Well, I want to tell you what I thought. When you walked in at Vengeance Day, and the smoke was around you, and all we saw was a shadow, I said, is Oba walking in wearing some Jenko jean shorts? Those are baggy, and I realized they're just your quads. These are just your quads. This is how you are built. It was amazing. But you walked in there, right, and you have this match with Dragon Lee. Dragon Lee, a guy who's been around the world, facing some of the biggest superstars that there are. You did what you did on a massive stage. What were your takeaways from that experience?
Honestly, the big goal was to defeat Dragon Lee that night, which I did. And Dragon Lee is a very, very, very experienced and very seasoned wrestler. And honestly, me defeating Dragon Lee is one of the notches I put on my belt. Like, I wear that badge with honor. After the fact, I just took the opportunity to soak in the crowd, you know, the 5,000 people chanting my name and acknowledging the moment with me. And that was special to me. That moment in general was very, very special to me, especially when I turned my back to the camera and faced the crowd and I soaked it in just for just a few seconds. It was magical.
You talk about the notches that are on your belt, the feathers that are in your cap, and it feels like you're getting a lot of feathers very, very quickly. And this is a good thing, but this can be concerning too. You know, people who get success early sometimes have trouble keeping that keeping that ball rolling. Now that you have the North American Championship on your shoulder, you've got the victory over Dragon Lee at Vengeance Day, what are the goals that you have in front of you?
Obviously, taking the belt to Stand and Deliver and retaining against whoever is put in front of me, that is the goal. Also, I mean, you saying that, like, my success has been meteoric and fast, which will lead to a burnout and it might slow down later. I mean, I can't worry about that. Right now, I have the gas, so my foot is on the pedal. So I'm going. Like, whoever you put in front of me, smash. Dragon Lee, smash. Lexus King, smash. Brooks Jensen, smash. Josh Briggs, smash. Even Wesley, when he comes back, I know he's going to work towards trying to get this title back. Smash. as a matter of fact, he's going to come just in time to go back to the Shodri room, honestly. So I'm just going to take the time to soak in this moment and just dominate whoever is put in front of me.
Well, speaking of smashing, you smashed records at Alabama in your life before you became a WWE superstar. You were an All-American shot putter. Thank you so much to Coach Derrett Yush from the University of Alabama for sending us this footage, and Roll Tide. But I wanted to ask you, have you been able to take anything away from your track and field career and transition it and use it to help you in your career as a sports entertainer?
Other than throwing opponents halfway across arenas.
Yeah, I mean, look at that.
Well, obviously, yes, I've definitely taken away some lessons from my throwing career. There's I could tell you the generic stuff, you know, focus, discipline. But the biggest thing I took away from being a successful D1 shot putter was that it takes a lot more than people think it takes to get to the top. Like, when people realize how much work they actually have to put in to become what they dream about being, they give up on the dreams instantly. Being a shot putter taught me to stay in deep waters, very, very deep waters. There was days where I trained so hard that, like, I questioned my existence. I questioned everything I had done up to that point. It just takes so much work and hard work to become everything you want to be. And that lesson has carried on with me here to the WWE.
And once again, we want to give a shout out to Coach Yush over at Alabama, who sent us that footage of Oba Femi. Fantastic stuff. Very impressive. But Oba, I want to switch gears a little bit. It is the month of February, and here at WWE, we are celebrating Black History Month. What does Black History Month mean to you, and who are some people that you have looked up to and aspired to be like?
Well, Black History Month means a lot. I mean, obviously, look at me. It means everything to me. And as far as superstars that I've looked up to, there's Big E. I enjoyed seeing Big E realize his dreams in the ring. Kofi with Kofi Mania. These are people that have shown that, like, it's possible, and that, like, the color of your skin is not a limitation at all. And we also have the 5-time King Booker. We also have Booker T.
That was good. That was really good. Wait, do that again.
Yeah, where'd that come from?
5-time.
Yes.
I'm a huge fan of Booker T. I've always, growing up, he's the one I watched when I was growing up. So huge fan. Huge fan. I've watched him evolve from, you know, 5-time Booker T to King Booker, back to Booker T, the veteran again. Like, I've enjoyed every moment of him being in the ring and outside. I enjoy his commentary too. I love he puts me over all the time.
Absolutely incredible. Sorry, I just can't get over that impression. It was phenomenal. But we had such an overwhelming fan response to you coming on the show today. This one fan question really caught my eye from Deshaun. Hey, Oba, congratulations on your success so far. Where do you see yourself in the next 3 to 5 years, and what accolades do you want to add to your resume? Take that anywhere you want to take it.
Okay. NXT champion, main roster. WWE champion. Why not?
Whoa! That's quick.
Oh, yes.
Smash. Smash.
Locked in.
Smash. Just smash. Keep smashing.
Yes. Smash away. You're locked in and focused. And before we let you go, I got to ask, do you have any final words to anybody in WWE that might step up and try to take that title off of you?
Oh, yeah. I have one word. Well, actually, I have several words. Come and get it. Just come. I'm inviting you, because you think you're coming for an opportunity, but you're coming to get destroyed. You're getting thrown in the lion's den. So bring it.
Oba, thank you so much for taking the time. Just one day removed from your title defense. We appreciate you, and we hope to have you back on the bump again soon.
Definitely. I would love to come back.
Thank you, Ova. Smash, smash, I think smash, baby. Look out, Oba Femi. The era has begun.
I have a new favorite. I have a new favorite WWE superstar.
I thought you were unbiased. I thought you were Sami Switzerland.
I mean, it is what I would be saying. You got to let me finish. If I were just a fan, but I'm an unbiased journalist.
Yes, you are. You are Sami Switzerland. No favorites whatsoever. We want to give a shout out to Rhea Ripley for coming on the show today. You guys, don't forget on Sunday, me, Sam Roberts, Ryan Popola, we're recapping the Elimination Chamber. So come hang out right here on Peacock, all of WWE social as well. Big weekend again, 3 days away from the Elimination Chamber, but that will do it for another edition of WWE's The Bump. Thank you guys so much for watching. For Sam Roberts and Ryan Popola, I'm Megan Morant, and we'll see you guys next time.